In the beginning, there was code. The constant unending flow of hundreds of thousands and sometimes even millions of lines of code. Usually written by programmers and software developers in isolation, this code was a massive web of complex computing instructions that were difficult to read and test, let alone extend with additional functionality. To solve this problem, developers and programmers invented the concept of what we call modular programming. Modular programming is a general programming approach that involves separating a program's functions into independent building blocks, each containing all the parts needed to execute a single aspect of the functionality. When put together, these modules make up the final executable program. Let's have a look at an example. Imagine that you are tasked to clean the living room. A program for cleaning the living room would look something like this. Program, clean living room. If there are toys on the floor, remove the toys. End. If the rug looks messy, vacuum the rug. End. If there are spots on the floor, wipe the floor with a wet mop. End. With remove the toys, vacuum the rug, and wipe the floor as different functions of the program. Each of these functions would require some additional instructions and conditions. Using the modular approach, we can create a separate independent program, also known as a module, that'll house those additional instructions and conditions. For example, a module for the function vacuum the rug would look something like this. Program, vacuum the rug. Find the vacuum in the basement. Check if the vacuum is charged. If there is not enough charge, charge the vacuum. End. Carry the vacuum to the main floor. Start the vacuum. Vacuum a lap around the outside of the rug. While the rug is not fully vacuumed, vacuum a lap around the inside of the previous lap. End. Turn off the vacuum. Move the vacuum to the basement. End. Now, if you look carefully at the program, we still have subtasks like charge the vacuum to accomplish, which we can flesh out further. For example, a module for charging the vacuum would look something like this. Program, charge the vacuum. Locate the charger, find the available outlet, plug the charger in the outlet. While the vacuum is not fully charged, let the vacuum charge. End. Remove the charger from the outlet, put the charger back where it belongs. End. You get the idea. Here, every function is really a series of functions. Every module can and often should be broken into smaller modules. The smallest module with the highest granularity that cannot be broken down into further modules is called a unit. To make the programs more robust, extreme programming, which is an agile framework, suggests that developers add a few additional lines of code to these units to test their functionality right from the get-go. You might have heard the term unit tests. This is what it refers to. Okay, so modules are like building blocks, where each block represents an independent, robust, and testable piece of code that can be stacked together in the end to create the full product. This stacking together of different modules is what we call merging the code, or code integration. Let's walk through an example software development and deployment process to understand it better. Imagine that you own an online bookstore, where customers can come, search for their favorite book, add the book to the cart, log into their account, pay for the book, and select a shipping method. Each of these functions of the online bookstore can be coded separately as modules. Let's also imagine that you outsourced the creation and maintenance of the online bookstore to an external vendor. Let's call the vendor EasySoft. EasySoft created the bookstore as an online app and then deployed, or in simple words, installed the app on a cloud service like Microsoft Azure or Amazon Web Service, popularly known as AWS. Once deployed, the customers of your online bookstore could access it online through their web browsers. Now, for us to understand the software development and the deployment process, we need to zoom into how EasySoft creates the software. For simplicity's sake, let's imagine that EasySoft is an agile vendor that creates the software using Scrum. They have a product owner and three different Scrum teams. Each Scrum team is responsible for creating and maintaining separate independent modules of the online bookstore software. Team 1 is responsible for the search and add to cart module. Team 2 is responsible for the login module. And team 3 is responsible for payment and shipping module. The EasySoft product owner talks to the customer, which in this case is you, and gathers all the requirements. With the help of the Scrum Master, the product owner then converts these requirements into user stories. These user stories are then stored in a convenient product backlog, which the team then prioritize and estimate to create a release plan. I've already covered prioritizing and estimating the user stories and creating a release plan in a different tutorial series. You can find the link to the series in this corner. Okay, after creating the release plan, the three teams select the work they need to work on during a sprint planning meeting. During the sprint, each of the three teams checks the code they created into a separate folder, also known as a repository, which is specific to each module. These repositories are located within what we call a source control system, which is nothing but a software tool that manages code check-ins. The source control system is installed on a separate dedicated machine. The most common and popular source control systems include AWS Code Commit, Microsoft's Team Foundation Server, GitHub, IBM's ClearCase, Bitbucket, and Subversion. Besides the three Scrum teams, EasySoft also has a dedicated integration team and a dedicated operations team. The integration team owns the working and maintenance of the source control system. This team is responsible for merging, also called integrating, all of the work from the three teams into one code. They do it once at the end of each sprint. The integrated code is stored in a separate folder called the mainline repository within the source control system. After merging the code, the integration team then builds the code. Now, what do I mean by building the code? The source code that the integration team receives from the development teams is not machine readable. Computers only understand the language of zeros and ones. The integrated source code is in human readable language. Code building, or building the code, is done by a build tool that converts or compiles this human readable source code into zeros and ones. The source code converted into zeros and ones is called the executable code or compiled code. The integration team then sends this executable code as a compressed file to the operations team, along with the instructions to deploy, or in simple words, install the software to various environments. Environments like dev test environment for QA to do all sorts of end-to-end tests, to a staging environment for user acceptance testing, and finally, when all the tests are done, to the production environment. Once available to the production environment, the product or the product update is available for the end users or customers to use. This is the typical process that most Scrum teams follow in various organizations. There are many problems with this process though. In the upcoming videos, we will see what those problems are and how the practices like continuous integration and continuous delivery can help us solve those problems. If you like this video, then give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and don't forget to provide your valuable feedback in the comments. I'll see you in the next video.